it's Sarah, and I'm taking a break from wood burning today. I'm going to do this little random act of Christmas kindness. This is a pattern that you can download from Facebook, and I will put the link in the description box, and it's by Tracy Moreau. I'm not sure how to pronounce it, M-O-R-E-A-U, and she says, I'm going to read it to you. It says, "Random acts of Christmas kindness. I am a firm believer that if you cannot do big things, then do small things in abundance. The holiday season is often difficult for some, and the stresses of everyday life during the season can feel compounded. Try brightening someone's day with this little gift. Give them to the cashier at your favorite shop, the bank teller, the elderly lady in line behind you, or anyone that you can think of that could use a dose of Christmas cheer. It can be a total stranger or the lady next door. A small and simple act of kindness can do a great deal to make a person's holiday season feel a little brighter. Merry Christmas." And I just thought that was such a cute, and I said on Facebook, I was like, I'm in. And so I've been making these. I made them yesterday, and I figured I might as well film it. She also posted the one that she did from last year, which is this little cute snowflake on a doily background. And I guess Michaels had them, and because it says Michaels Crafts Recollections wooden round lacy tags. And I went on the website, and I don't think they have them, and they're small. So, you know, they do sell those laser cut wood pieces, and I looked all over and they didn't have them. I'm going to go through my stash though, because I think I do have something similar. Oh, I have these. I did. I have these. So I think I'm going to paint some of these up. I haven't gotten to them yet, but they're sitting in my stash. I have all these little wooden doilies, so I'm going to probably do these as well. It seems like they're going to paint up real fast, especially the snowman. I haven't done this one yet, but today I'm going to do this Santa. So here he is. Now, it seems like I missed out on this again, because it says Michaels wooden tag 2 by 2.5. And I looked for them and they're gone. So what I did find, and I went back and got more today, were these, and they're by Art Minds, and they're in the wood aisle. It's a 6-piece. I thought I got more yesterday. I must have gotten 2 packs. They're 3 by 2, but if you look at the pattern, it's pretty much perfect. So I've been going to town. So I made all these. I have a couple more left. I have 3 more left of those. And these I made as ornaments. So I'm going to drill a little hole in the top with my Dremel. And let me zoom in a little bit. But they're super cute. I mean, you guys, you can make these out of chipboard probably, you know, but they work up so quick. So I'm going to take you through and just do a quick tutorial with you on how to make these. And I had, this was cool, like I love going through my stash and using what I have, and I'm really, this year that's been my theme, use what you have. So I found these flat back pearls, and they just look perfect for the little pom-pom on the end of his hat. I mean, so cute. So she had you do a little bell with a ribbon, which is super adorable. I did this little red one with silver. And then on the back, I put a sentiment, and I kind of, I stamped some metallic gold snowflakes. They didn't come out. This one I just painted, let's see. But like you can kind of see it, and it says, "When you stop believing in Santa, you get socks and underwear." So that, I'll make those into ornaments. But for this, I'm just going to do them the way she has it, and it's as a pin. So we don't really need to decorate the back. I'm probably just going to paint it a solid color, because then you're going to glue a pin to it. All right, so I'll be back. I'm going to gather up my supplies, and I will show you how to make this super cute little ornament or pin, all right, for your random act of kindness. I'll be right back. All right. The first thing you want to do is you're going to gather up a few things. You're going to need the little pieces of wood or chipboard, whatever you have, and some papers that you can decoupage onto. So you, as you look at these, you see these have little words. This is, oh look, a map. Look how cute the map looks. I love it. So Tracy shows on hers, and you know what I was looking for was something like this, something with a flourish. See this little Santa beard? That's scrapbook paper under there. So, you know, I love the music notes though, super cute. So what I did was I just grabbed, you know, Allie Cutter. Hi, Allie. She sent me a box of ephemera. And these are actual music book pages, storybook pages. See, this is scrapbook paper. It's much stiffer. So these papers are really good for decoupage. But there's, I mean, there's dictionary pages, and it would all look super cool. So, and then these are regular scrapbook pages. This is actually Halloween music paper, but you couldn't tell, like, I cut, like, see this one. You can't tell that it's Halloween, unless you can read music, I guess. But this is actual, real, music pages. And some of these, like, I was just looking at it. Allie actually wrote the date on here. Let's see. August 3rd through 1920. August 3rd, 1920. So, I mean, this is super old, you guys. But August 10th. I don't know, but I just saw those really old dates on there and thought, well, I'm going to cut it up. So, what I'm going to do, I'm going to set this aside. So yeah, gather up any type of ephemera that you want to put underneath here. I mean, it's not really going to be seen that much. And I'm going to grab my paper cutter. I'm going to cut this down. You know what? I think this is actually two pages. All right, they just made paper really thick back then. But it feels like, I don't know, it feels like two pages, but I don't think it is. All right, I'm just going to cut it down so that the music notes. It's, oh dear. I guess I have a dull blade. Hold on. Do over. Let's do a do over on that. Try not to rip the paper. Gently. I guess I have a dull blade on here. This is not working out. Anyway, what you want to do is cut this down to, these are, what, 2 by 3? Let's see, 2 by 3. So I'm going to go 2 1/4 by 3 1/4 if I can get this to cut. So I really think this is 2 sheets, but it's not. Okay, let's try that again. 2 1/4. It is not cutting. All right, we're going to skip that. We'll go back to something that will cut. Let's try this one. 2 1/4 by 3 1/4. See that cut? I don't know. Maybe that old paper was just not good. All right. Anywho. Sorry about that. 2 1/4 by 3 1/4. And I'm making it go in the right direction, too, because, you know, I don't want it to be sideways. So that's it. I'm going to adhere that with Mod Podge. And I haven't really done anything to this. Let me see. These have like little splintery things on the side. So, I mean, you're going to sand it in a minute anyway, but if you want to get the main splintery things off, I would go downstairs. I have a little sanding machine down there. So I'm going to wait, and we're just going to adhere this on. So I have, look at my Mod Podge. I'm almost out of it. And I had to cut the lid off because it was stuck. So I'm going to take this and go straight onto the wood. And I like to put a little bit on the paper too, but because this is so thin, I think I'm going to do it. I put it on the paper too. And you want it, make sure your edges are good because you don't want it to come up on the edges. And then I just center it on there. So I turn it around and kind of center it and push it down on those edges. Then we got to let it dry. Push out your air bubbles. Oops. You have wiggle room. It's definitely, it doesn't adhere right away. And that's it. So now it says, grieve me, see here. I don't know. I don't think that's good necessarily. Let me come up. I forgot I was zoomed in. Sorry. Sorry. All right. So we have to let that dry. So I'm going to just do a few of them and I'll be back. The next step is really to, I'm going to paint the back and be done with the back. So I'll be right back. All right. I did like four of them. Look at this one. It's all crooked and everything. And, you know, I forgot about, like, when you use decoupage, you really kind of need to push your any bubbles out, too. And I didn't do that. I was rushing, so I'll be more careful when I'm not on video. And then just cut away that little quarter inch around from the back here. And you're going to sand it. And it's, I took the other these other ones downstairs and did it, like I said, on my little... It's not a palm sander. It's like a real sanding machine. It's my husband's. But you want to go with the... So facing you, I'll show you. You go, you pull it toward you, and you sand that little edge of the paper. And it really becomes part of the wood then. It's kind of, it's really cool. So, and you can do the corners too. And... It just makes it perfect. And then you have this little surface. And you can do, I would do my edges. I like it to feel smooth, but you're going to paint it anyway. You're going to put whatever embellishments you want to do on here. All right, so I'm going to set that one aside. So then, oops, the next step you want to do, and see, because the decoupage is on there, I can get this paint off that I messed up. I base coated the backs of mine just to finish off the back, and I did it with honey brown. I don't know why I chose honey brown, but I liked it because it's an antique-y looking color, and also I'm going to put gold. I'm going to use this Dazzling Metallics. This is the Glorious Gold on top of it, so it makes it show up better. I'll show you what I mean. Let me get this cleaned off. So yeah, and I didn't seal them or anything, or I just went straight paint to wood. So you probably could sand it a little. Let me just sand it. It's easier this way. And it looks rough, but really it's just an undercoating for this gold paint, which is going to look beautiful. And we're, like I said, you're just going to put a pin on here anyway. But if you just did the gold paint by itself on the raw wood, it wouldn't look opaque. It would be very see-through. So look, now you just have this shiny gold surface. And at the very end, we'll come back and do the edges. Like, I'll just take my finger and go around all the edges, because we'll probably get paint on the edges right now. But look, I did a piece of map again. I don't know where in the world it is. North Vietnam, it says. Ooh, there's Thailand. So, I love the way the maps look. I'm just getting off this. I like that the decoupage is wipeable. So I'm going to let that dry, but see how, look how gold it looks now. And then you'll just glue your pin to the back of that, all right? So your back is done, pretty much. So you just want to... And if you want to do it silver, do it silver. It's use what you have. That's what I am definitely wanting everyone to do, because I have so much paint. I am not going to go buy anything. I'm going to use what I have, all right? So the next thing you want to do, I had four of these. Why don't I have four? One, two, three, who knows? Oh, here it is. I want to, so yeah, you'll just paint all of them with the honey brown first, and then you go over the honey brown with the gold, all right? And then you'll be done. But what I want to do is sand this a little bit, because that Mod Podge, the whatever, you could probably use matte medium even. Whatever decoupage glue you use, it has a little bit of a shine to it. So I'm just taking that down a little bit because my graphite, I found this out yesterday, is so old. I use this really old piece of graphite paper, which it's the carbon paper, this. Mine's really old. I have a bunch of them and they're all old. So it wasn't showing up very well on here, so I had to sand it down a little bit. But the first, before you do that, you're going to take this pattern and you're going to trace it onto tracing paper. So just take your regular old piece of tracing paper and lay it over there and just use a pencil and trace all your lines for your little pattern, right? Then I cut it off, and I have one here somewhere that I used. Here it is. And I cut it actually on the beard because you don't need, there's nothing really down here because I wanted to put a piece of washi. And I'm probably going to need a new piece of washi. It's not very sticky. But that's just to hold it in place. So then when you're ready to go, you're ready to trace your pattern, I'm going to take a piece of washi. And I like to trace at least three in a row. Like I would do three of these at a time. So I kind of have a little, what's it called? Like a procession line, or I can't think of the word today. Concession? What am I trying to think of? I know you guys are yelling at the screen right now. You know I have hypothyroid and they say it takes your brain, your memory away. I don't know why. All right. So I'm lining this up. It's a tiny bit bigger than this wood, so I'm just making it even on both sides. Let me go in. But I'm going to be able to fit most of them on there, and I'll put a piece of washi there. And then I stick my graphite paper underneath, and hopefully it'll show up. I'll be able to see it. I don't know how good you guys will be able to see it. And I'm going to outline just the main lines because I don't need the eyes yet. That's really all I don't need. I'm going to put everything else on there. Because the eyes, I'm going to color that whole thing first, skin tone color, and then I'll come back and put the eyes on top of it. It's just easier. I've learned that throughout my years of painting. You don't want to have to paint around a little thing. It's much easier to put them on after. So let's see if I got everything. I missed one spot. See, that's why it's great that you have this, so you can just go back down. I didn't put this top part of the mustache. All right, I can see everything. I don't know that you guys can, but you don't need to see it because I'll have paint on there in a second. So once you've gotten your pattern on there, like I said, I would have like these three ready to go. I would start doing all, you know, just keep base coating them in. So it's like an assembly line. Yay, that's what I mean. And actually, I should do it, but because, no, I'm not. I'm just going to skip around. Now, for paint, Tracy has listed a few colors here. Flesh tone, Tuscan red, lamp black, asphaltum warm white, antique green. And I didn't have a lot of those colors, so I just grabbed what I had. And I am using primary red. I did have the flesh tone, so I'm using that. Instead of warm white, I think I'm using light buttermilk. Where are you? Here it is. So I'm just going to put a little bit of each color out. Can you even see what I'm doing? Because I'm zoomed in. And what else do I need? Black. And red. I got that. Okay. And you need a couple brushes. So this stuff is all pretty small, so I wouldn't go too big. A small flat brush could do it. Maybe I'll use that. Or definitely like a number three round. But let's just go ahead and whenever I paint, I always use water in my brush. So I'll put my brush in water and then blot it on a paper towel. I'm going to pull it into the picture here. Let's go. My desk always crowds toward me, all the stuff I get on here. So I have water in my bristles, and then I'll come over to, let's start with the warm white because it's the lightest color. And you're going to paint this, the fur on his cap. And I prefer to do two thinner coats, nice and smooth. I like to pull my, any ridges that I create with the brush and get them nice and smooth. There's a little bit over here. And that's it. So I've filled that in. Let me go in a little. Rinse my brush, and I'm going to use the same brush, and I'm going to do the little part of his face. I think I'm going to use my round brush for that because of that little nose. So this is a number 3 round brush. Water, blot, and flesh tone. And I water the paint down a little bit, not too much. And I'm going to turn my piece so I can see what I'm doing. And put in. I'm going to do the nose. Now on her directions, she has you doing the nose in the red, the same color as the hat. But I chose to change it. Sorry, Tracy. I just want to give him a shiny nose instead of a red nose. I didn't need to put it, sorry. Always have a Q-tip too. I love Q-tips as a tool. I just want to leave a little piece of hair on the side. I just like it like that. So that's one thin coat. So let's go back now to the red. I'll go back to my bigger brush and get some red. See, I load my brush. I don't just pull from the puddle and go to the piece. That's just from years of painting. And you're just going to go over the whole hat, this little top of his hat that's flopped over, and we'll connect a little pom-pom to that. Now Tracy also put a ribbon with a bell, which I love. It's super cute and jangly. I found those little pearl flat backs in my stash, but I was thinking an actual pom-pom like would look cute that you get at the in the kids department. See, I'm getting red on the edge, but we'll go over that at the end. Would look so cute to have a real little pom-pom, just glue it there. So see, now you can kind of see the shape. I'm going to put a little bit of black where his lips are. So I'm going to make a triangle, basically, right here under his nose. A little crooked. And then later we'll add the lip, but this is like the shadow behind the lip. Excuse me, I'm having a fog. A little fog is in my throat. Tommy's growling too. Alright, so see, you can start to see them come to life. We'll go back to the white. Well, it's light ivory. Do a second coat. But see, so when you're doing your assembly line, you can do all your red, 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 and then you'd be ready for your second coat of red probably by the time you came back, you know? So they work up really, really quick. And it's such a cute, oh man, it's super cute when it's done. Thank you, Tracy. I love it. And, you know, you can just put the TV on. And it's really, you don't have to think. Once you've made a few of them, it's really kind of, you just go on automatic pilot. And, you know, what is it, like 3 colors, 4 colors? And once we get to the floating, which is what I love to float. That's the technique we're going to use to shade everything. It's 1 color. She uses asphaltum, which I used burnt umber. And it just, you shade the whole thing. Well, actually, the hat gets shaded with black. But basically, it's super easy. So, very few colors. And you're done. You know, it works up so quick. And then you have something to give, like those people, my neighbors that I see all the time when I'm walking the dog. I think I'm going to give them one, a couple of them. And, you know, maybe a few other people out there, maybe some random people that I haven't planned. Someone that's nice to me, or maybe it's someone who's mean to me. Oop, my stomach's growling, sorry. You know, and I'll just shock them and give them a random act of kindness and see what they do. That could be cool. I'll give one to Maya to give her teacher, my granddaughter Maya. And, you know, I want to do those other snowflake ones too. They're super cute. I think they would probably work up even quicker. I mean, they're basically just white and then a little snowman face on there, you know? So I'm going back for my second coat of red. And I mean, you guys, you don't really need to see me do this, but I like to use the edge of my brush to get up to those edges. And like I said, I'd much rather have two smooth coats, two thinner smooth coats, than one thick gloppy coat. And that's basically it. We're not going to do the mustache. The mustache and the beard stay with the decoupage paper, but you can still see the decoupage paper a little bit. Like, you can still see it through the hat. Can't really see it on this. And then when I did these, yeah, you can't really see much through the hat. Well, a little bit, but it's mostly the beard and the mustache. So I need a little bit more on the face. I want that to be opaque. So I'm going to come back when that's all dry and we'll start shading. All right, I'll be right back. Okay, I've got three going here. I am all base coated. Oh, the one thing I wanted to do was, you don't really need to, but if you want to, now would be the time for you to take your tracing, which I had, and I can't, here it is now. And get your eyes on there, which you don't need to trace them on. I'm going to eyeball it. But you can trace on these little, the holly berries and leaves and the eyes and eyebrows. Because now you're base coated, you can go ahead and put those final details on there. I'm going to wing it. And we're going to float. Now, floating is a technique that I love. And a lot of people get frustrated with it, and I understand, but I'm a pretty good teacher at this specific technique, so I'm gonna tell you how to do it, and you just have to practice. That's all it is. It is a matter of practice and understanding what you're trying to accomplish, okay? So I'm gonna show you what a float is. Let me get some. We're gonna need, for the first thing I want to do though is take a little bit of the red and pink. I forgot about this. We got to give them a lip. And we're going to mix a little bit of the pink with like the flesh tone, just whatever's left on your palette, and make like a pink color because the red won't show up on the black. So the first thing, you're just going to put a little, give them a lip, a pink lip, and then we'll go over it with red in a minute. But you need to get, it won't show up if you just go straight red. So we're going to give them a little pink lip. This one I got a pill in my paper. My black went too big and I rubbed it, and you gotta be careful with decoupage. That's what I'm finding. I'll be able to fix it, but you know, it's fun because I'm loving that she's bringing in the mixed media aspect of this by doing the decoupage. It's not just classic toll painting or decorative painting. You're bringing in that element of collage, and I love it. I love, love, love it that decorative painting is now coming back around because people are adding other elements of mixed media. So like adding this, makes it mixed media too, because we're using other things, okay? So anyway, let's float. All right. So like I said, to do most of this, she uses asphaltum, which is just a brown. I'm going to use burnt umber, and I'm going to put it right on my paper palette. Now a paper palette, and I'm going to, well, it's a mess. I have so much stuff, but I want to show you the cover. Palette paper. It says it right there. And this is the Strathmore brand, but any brand is fine. Use a coupon. That's what I always do. You're going to need some paper towels. And I have a bunch of old used up ones, and then they dry and I keep using them. Doesn't really matter. They don't have to be clean. I float with an angle brush, and you can use a flat brush as well. You can do the same thing with a flat, and I'll try to do a, here, I'll grab this flat and I'll show you the technique with a flat brush. But I prefer an angle brush because you can take the tip of that angle and stick it in nooks and crannies that I just like it better. So that's my preference, but you can float with either or. So let me put out a little bit of burnt umber onto my palette paper, which it's kind of like a waxy surface. You could probably, if you don't have that, use your mat, this whatever kind of mat, this Tim Holtz thing. It has a slick surface, so you could probably do it and practice on that. I'm gonna erase real quick too. Sorry, I'm a little sidetracked. Oh boy, desk. I'm looking for my pink eraser. Got it. I just wanna, I see some pretty strong tracing lines on here, and I'm just gonna erase them real quick, because I know where I'm going now. I have a pretty good, especially over here where I've already painted. So I'm just erasing any visible, and they may not come off because I've painted over them. But you can erase anything that you don't like. All right, good. Now I'm gonna do all three of these because I can work on, we're gonna do the hat, the face, the mustache and beard, all with burnt umber. And I'm going to just show you the technique first. So I'm going to move this into the shot, and I don't need that. Got my water bucket, so I go water. Let's pull out a little bit. Okay, so I go water, blot on your paper towel, and the paper towel sucks the water out of the brush. So you don't go like this, you don't just go like that. You kind of want to go blot. Let it suck the water out a little bit. So you want water in the brush, but it doesn't want to be drippy. Corner load, and I'll show you with the flat brush the same thing, but I'm going to take a little bit of paint onto the corner of my brush. Then I'm going to put that down with all the bristles on the surface. So the angle brush, you don't just want the tip, you want to turn your brush so that all those bristles touch the surface. And just start to push the paint into the bristles. Go both ways. Now, if you look, and I'm kind of moving into it somewhat, in and out. So I go in, out, but you don't want this edge to ever get into the paint. You only want water on this edge. So basically you want it to go from darkest color here, medium, light, water. And you can kind of see that on here. Let me come in. So you're getting a variation of color, and this creates your shading and highlighting. Now the mop brush comes into play. Alright, so that, if you like what you see on your palette paper, then you're loaded and ready to go. You can go to your piece. But the mop brush comes into play, and this one specifically is by Maxine Thomas, who is such a terrific floater. You're going to take the mop and you're basically mopping the water's edge. So you're pulling the water, you're mopping it up. This doesn't get wet. You don't put this in the water. You only pick up water with the mop. And you can soften out your float. So when you're on your piece, this is a good tool to have as well. Now let me show you how I do it with a flat brush. Same thing. Let me come up a little so you see what I'm doing. Same thing. Water, blot. And this is a watercolor brush, so it holds a lot of water. So I'm going to blot a couple times. But you need water in there, okay? And I'm going to corner load again. Just take a corner of the brush. and you put it down, all the bristles on the surface, pushing the paint through. That's, you're floating the paint across the water. That's why it's called a float. And you get a variation of color. Now, if this is too wet, I can just go blot again and come right back over. And now when I go to my piece, I'm gonna put all the bristles on the surface, touching this edge with the darkest part of the brush, because that's where I want the darkest shade to be, and tickling it along that edge, turn the piece and bring it around this side. And then if you want to, and usually I don't have to, but you can soften it with your mop brush. Now, I just love using an angle brush, and we'll float a little bit now, okay? So we'll go to our pieces. So I'm gonna corner load, work it into the brush. And I like a big, at least 5/8 inch angle, because it holds a lot of water and a lot of paint. So I can do all three of these with one load of my brush. And there's a lot of water there, but I blotted. All right, let's go to this guy. I wanna make sure I'm in the shot. Now, you're an angle brush, so this edge has to be even with the edge that you want. All the bristles on the surface, so I want the water too. I don't just want the paint, I need the water too. And then I'm gonna turn it around and stick that corner. See how that little corner? But see, I have so much paint on here, I can come over to here and get a float over there. I can go under this mustache, and I would probably want this much darker, but I have a lot of paint and water on my brush. And actually, it's better to go light in the beginning, because you can always make it darker. Now I'm gonna just go into water, blot, corner load, and do it again. Now see how much paint I put down there? I'm gonna leave most of it there. And the next time I need to reload, I can just come back to this little runway. But I like a lot of paint. I like to do my float once and be done, one and done. So look how much paint is here. But I just think it makes it so rich. And watch when you use your mop. So I can do more, but I want to show you. So I'm going to see how it's dark. But you pat it, pat the water, just the water's edge, and start to kind of, you can pull the paint into the water a little bit, and it gives it that, like, see, I didn't do anything with this, it's still loaded. And I have plenty of paint and water on the brush, so I'm going to do the same thing on this side. But see how I tuck the bristles up into that edge there? And I like that just the way it is. And it kind of gives it a rounded shape. So I'm coming right back to my runway here, and I'm gonna just make sure I have enough, because I know I do, but I'm gonna start under, am I in the shot? Under this mustache here, with the tip. All the bristles are on the surface though, not just the tip, because I need the water. If you look, you can see me laying down water over there. And done. I'm not gonna touch it because I like dark floats. So I'm gonna put a little bit on right here, kind of on his hair, to separate the mustache from his hair. We can put a little bit, and this is all, this brush will go on forever. Once you load it right, you don't need to worry about it. Next to the nose, above the lip and next to the nose, put a little shade there. And we're gonna do along the bottom. Try not to put your fingers, you have to let it, acrylic paint dries really fast, but it doesn't dry that fast. So you can pick up what you did. If you stick your finger in a float, you have to let it set and dry. But look how good that's already starting to look. It's starting to come to life, right? Let's do, I'm going to switch to my smaller brush, because here, I'm such a heavy hand that I when I use this big brush, I can get out of control. So I like to tame myself down with this little brush, which this is a little 3/8 inch angle. Same thing, water, blot, corner load, but we're gonna do his face. See, that's what's so easy about this. We're not switching colors to do, see, that's a little bit, I'm gonna rinse my brush. I think I got too much paint on this end. I don't want any paint. I'm just gonna push into this puddle and load it that way because there was so much paint. Yeah, that's good. All right, and now we're gonna go right up against the brim of the hat here. All the bristles on the surface up against the side of his cheek, and I'm pushing the tip, the color, up into that line. So I want it to come right along the brim of the hat there, the fur. And it looks a little choppy, so I'm just gonna gently, gently touch it, all right? I love to float, you guys. This is fun for me, and I know it can be frustrating. So I want you to practice on your palette, because whatever's happening here is basically what you're gonna get here. So if you're getting a stripe, like if you just have a stripe of color, see, I can't even do it, but you're gonna get a stripe of color here. So, and if in the beginning, you might just get a very stripey float, and you know what? It's gonna be okay. It'll look okay. It'll still be, you know, it'll look shaded, but you, and then next time you look at it, or I'm sorry, that's not what I mean. The next piece you do should get better and better. So when you put a date on your work, you know, so put December 2016. Then when you make your Santas next year, each year they'll get better and better, you'll see. I mean, if you really practice, I want to do a much bigger float here. So I'm going to just go ahead and float now and do all this shading and highlighting, kind of just going back and forth. This guy looks pretty good. He needs it a little bit down here. Hopefully I'm in the shot because my camera is a little forward. I could probably bring it in a little because I tend to go here. Yeah, all right. I just have to move my tripod with my feet in a minute. All right, and what else? Let's put his lip on. We'll give him a lip. I'll get some red out, some nice fresh red. That's the thing about acrylic paint too. They'll dry up on your, so only put a little bit of paint out at a time. And that way it stays nice and fresh. You don't want to have hard paint to work with. But I'm gonna get out a little bit of red. And we can put his lip on now. So I'm just gonna take my little liner brush again. It's like a number one round, really. And we'll put that lip nice and red. This one's a fat lip. He's got smoochy lips. It's a little big, isn't it? But it looks okay. Now for his nose, I changed this from her directions, but I'm just gonna do a float on top of his nose, I'll show you, and his cheeks. So this is the red that we did the hat with. And I'm corner loading, and I'm doing the same thing we just did. We're gonna float this on there. So a little bit of red. And I'm gonna do the top of his nose. So the strongest color is toward the top of his nose. And you just kind of swoosh it around the top. I'm trying not to get it in the lip, actually. Flip it around, and we're going to put some from, let's see. Oh, we didn't put his eyes on yet. I got to put his eyes on first. All right, sorry. Put a little bit here. Yeah, I should have, before I did that, we could have put his eyes on, and then I'll show you how to do the cheeks. And a little bit of lip on him. So if I hadn't given you that lesson on floating, it would have taken us so quick. Like, I would be done by now. But I just really want you to understand the technique itself, because I've been in classes at convention, and the teacher's going through the motions and, you know, float here, float there. And I've been sitting next to people who did not know how to float, and the teacher really didn't give a detailed explanation. And, you know, it's disappointing. And so I would sit there and I would show them how to do it and stuff. And no one really ever explained, very few teachers, I have to say, explain it in a way that you can really understand it. And I think that's important. Like, you really need to understand what you're trying to do. They come over and they'll just go and do this. And, you know, I need to know why I'm doing it and what I'm trying to get out of it, you know? Anywho, this is the eye. So I just put out some black and I'm gonna use that little round brush. This is a number one, get some black. And if you've traced on your eyes, you won't have a problem. I'm going to wing it. And I'm just going to go, am I in the shot? Yes. I'm just going to put a few lines here, a little ways from my nose, and just make, so I'm going to do the same thing on this side. Try to make it the same. I like to flip it and then do the bottom. And you can make your eyes any way you want, but the point is, these are simple. And if you're going to make these assembly line style and crank them out, you know, make them the simplest way that you can make them, so you don't have to mess around. Now, one eye is bigger. Got to make him a little bigger. Does that look good? That looks good. I did change the eyes on one of these, and I don't love them like this. I gave them, like, I didn't even give them any color. It's just like a pupil in the middle, and then I put an eyelid. But, you know, he's cute anyway. All right. So, yeah, so you want to put, let me put eyes on him too. Why not? So, again, if you have your tracing, you're basically just blocking in that little tracing that she did. So, but he has little highlight. You'll see. We're going to put a little spot of white in there, and it just makes them come to life. They really, they're cute. So, and like I said, if you're cranking these out, you don't want some complicated 10-step eye, you know. Just give them an eye and call it a day. All right, so here's what I was talking about. Let me just do, I'm going to do a little bit more on, Kiwi's calling me, my birdie. I'm going to do some more umber real quick, because I just want to get caught up on this one and let those eyes dry a little bit, because I don't want to stick my brush in it. So let's go under here. Kiwi! Matt, you can bring her to me. He said she bites him. I'm going to put a little bit here to separate the mustache from the... But she's calling me. She hears me talking, and she wants to be in here with me. That's my Conyer. She's a little tiny green cheek Conyer. And she's in here with me a lot. All right, so we can do our cheeks now. I'm going to go back to my small brush, because I really don't want to overdo it and give them bright red cheeks, but... corner loading into the red a tiny bit. Look how much, I mean, I have a tiny bit of paint, and I'm really gonna try and keep it nice. And now I'm gonna start at the edge of his eyeball with the paint color up against the mustache, all the bristles on the surface, and just swoop it in there, turn it around. Well, I'm gonna go this way, turn the brush so the paint is up against the mustache, and swoop it in there and give him a cheek. A little rosy cheek kind of coming up from his mustache, right? And then you're going to put a little bit of the burnt umber, again, not too dark, but a little burnt umber right above his mustache. See, I had too much water on the brush. That's why I'm wiping it. So it's a know, you're gonna have to feel it out and see. When you know the brush isn't moving, you need more water. When it's not enough color, you need more color, you know. So I'm gonna put a little bit here, start at that side of the eye, color up against the nose, and stick it right there. And now he's got that. You can even shade his little mouth. I took a tiny bit of black, just a tiny bit. Walk away from it. See how I'm walking away? I'm gonna blot. It's a little wet. I want a tiny bit, so I'm walking away. Push it into the edge. And then I'm gonna put a tiny bit up against both sides of his lip. And that even might be a little too much. Did I do that on the other ones? I think I did. A little bit, because we're gonna highlight it. And it just gives it dimension. He needs a little shade above his nose and his cheeks too. And then we're gonna do some highlighting. Oops, you know what else? Let me just finish one, because I'm getting carried away with showing you all this different stuff. I need to take the burnt umber and go down the sides of his beard. Didn't do that yet. Here and here. I just want to go here. I didn't do his cheeks. Sorry, I changed my mind and I started. Because you can't go over things if they're not dry. So I'm gonna put his cheeks on. Little dark, but that's okay. He's in the North Pole. It's a little chilly there. And like, I'll just take my mop and kind of poke at it, and it calms it down. So that looks cute. Highlights. I'm gonna actually use white, and she doesn't have it as using white, but I do such dark floats that I thought the white would really brighten it up. So I have, this is just actually titanium white, Snow White. I need a little bit more of this first, because I'm going to show you what I did on the bottom to get it to get the beard highlighted. I'm just making sure I go down both sides. And oh, this one's done. All right, sorry. I think we're good. I'm caught up on both of these now. For the highlight, I'm using white, and I'm going to take a corner load of that white and my smaller angle brush, and I'm going to go. Now, watch what I do with the edge of my brush. So I have this on here. I'm starting at the edge, but I'm going to pull it around and tuck it like that, because I don't want to go and leave a line in the float in the middle. So again, I'm going to go this way. Let's see if you see what I'm saying. Watch how I turn the bristles of my brush. So I keep it up against the top, but then I'm going to tuck it up there. So I haven't left a line like this right across my shading. I hope you understood that. All right. Now I'm going to take the same thing, nice wet brush and a lot of paint, and I'm going to stick it in the middle, and I'm just going to go in a circle. And keeping the paint in the middle and the water towards the outside, I'm highlighting the center of the beard. Now you can do this with a dry brush technique as well, but this works for me. I like floating. I'm good at it, and I get the results I want, so why mess with it, you know? You could highlight so much more. Like, she doesn't have you doing it, but you could highlight your hat. And I need to tuck it up in and tuck it up in so that I don't just leave it aligned. So like for this, I'll start kind of on an angle. Am I in the shot? Like this. Start up against and pull it around. And then you're going to pull, and my brush kind of made an arc. And that way you don't get lines of water and paint that are just in the middle, because you can see that. It just looks much smoother. I think that's looking pretty good. We didn't shade our hat, so we're going to go in black. And the same thing. I'm side-loading my brush. I've picked it up. And I'm going to start at this end and pull the black along the fur of the cap. And I'm going to tuck it right here where it kind of folds over. I turned my brush so that it's tucked under there at the same angle. And you can kind of see I use so much paint. But I just want to soften it a little bit. And we're going to go down the side, just along that where the pom-pom is, just a little bit, right here at the corner. And I'm going to swoop it down up against that edge. But do you see what I mean by, like, you have to turn the bristles to direct so the water doesn't just stop across and then your paint puddles in there and then you have a line, you're left with a line. His lips are looking a little bit, what color could I use? I could just come back with the red. I just want to see if I could pop it up a little. They looked a little too. We're going to put a little white there at the end, actually. All right, you know what else we need? I think all of our shading is done on this guy. I'm going to put the hot, you know what we need? A little bit of green. This is taking a lot longer than I thought because I really spent a lot of time on the floating. So you're going to take a little bit, and I just used medium foliage green and my littlest. This is just a liner brush. I need to get a really good, this is a round actually. I need a good liner. And get it wet. Let me just show you what I'm doing here. Make it like a little bit more ink consistency instead of paint. And really pull the paint through the bristles. And you're going to make about like, look at your picture. See, look, if you pull it over here. Now there's my tracing stuck to the page. You can see those little, and mine never look like hers because mine are so big. She's got a very delicate touch. But you're just going to make about like three little sprigs of, what is this, like a pine needle looking thing, right? And just make little pine needles. That doesn't matter because when I'm going to shade them too. I'm going to show you. I did them my way because I couldn't do them. I don't have a good liner brush because if you do, you can make these lines so tiny. Mine are a little fat and I don't mind them. I don't mind it. I'm going to take black green. Could probably just even use black, but I have black green, so I'm just going to use that. I only need a tiny bit and I'm just going to do the same thing. Get it like ink. Load my brush. And just hit and miss now. I don't have to be on every, so just a couple. And I think it makes it look a little better. It makes it look a little more dimensional. And what else? I like to use a stylus when I do the dip dots. So for the berries, we're going to use the red, the same red that we've been using, but I like to use a stylus, and that's one of these dot making tools, one of these guys. So I'm going to go right into my puddle of red and put like three little dots near each sprig of the pine needles, or wherever you want to. I'm going to use the other side, the tiniest side, and take a dot of that white and put it right up in this corner of his eye. See that if you don't use it right there, and then maybe tap it off and put a tiny one down the bottom. That looks good. And you're gonna get your liner brush and put a little bit on the nose, just right here. Oops, that was too wet, but it looks okay because it's just a highlight. And a little on the lip. Gonna give them eyebrows with that. Oops, I dropped it in my black. With the white, I'm gonna give them some eyebrows. Or you could use the light buttermilk or whatever, but, and I just put a little comma, like a little, let me zoom in a little more. Right, like kinda halfway, and I just go like that. And I always flip it because I can't make them look the same at all. But there he is. Is that not the cutest thing ever? So you're done, basically. All right, so if you haven't, go back and add, and this one doesn't even, I haven't even painted it yet, but add your gold to the back. So this one's the one with the gold. You know, you can actually sand it if stuff got on the back of it. I think you're okay. Because remember, you're just going to stick a pin on the back. Let me zoom up. Oops. So once you're sure that everything looks good, be careful you don't mess up your dip dots too. They take a minute to dry. Oh, and you can shade down the side of the hat, but I don't think it needs, I'm sorry, highlight down the side of this hat, but I don't think it needs it. Gotta really make sure this is dry, and then you're gonna varnish. And Tracy uses glitter decoupage, and I haven't seen it, but I have the sparkle varnish from Folk Art that I've had for years, and it still works. And that's what I used, and it just adds glitter and makes it sparkly. So that's what I used. And I also then after, so before you varnish though, just make sure it's how you want it. Erase any lines, like I said. See, like I see a little red down there. I don't know how that got there. It's fine though. Let's see. It's coming off. See, you can before the acrylic paint totally sets, you can still get it off. And just double check, make sure it's how you want it, and then varnish. So erase lines, fix anything you want to fix, and then varnish, and then you're going to glue. Now, when I glued my little bells on here, I used E6000. That's just, it's, you're never going to have an issue because we are going to give these away. You don't want to make something that's going to fall apart. Yeah, that's on there. I tied the bell, so I have these bells. If you do the bells, where are they? Oh, geez. Why is my desk so chaotic? Okay. These are pretty bigger. They're pretty big. This is like, I don't know. So it has a decent size hole in it that you can stick. And I'm using, well, for the silver one, this was a little bit of a thinner ribbon. But I did use on the green, it's a thicker ribbon. So both of those sizes fit through the hole pretty well, see? So you put it through the hole, and then I just tie a knot and make a bow, and then I glue this. So I just would take this. This bow is a little straight for me. I'd rather have it open more. And then you're just going to take it and glue, put glue on the fabric, on the bow part, and just stick it with the E6000 and just stick it there, and so the bell becomes your little pom-pom, and that's it. But I'm going to use, like I said, I had these flat backs that I'm not using them for anything, and I think they're actually really perfect for this. So I'll just glue a little pom-pom at the bottom of his little, isn't that adorable? I love him. He's adorable. All right, you guys. Sorry I took so long with the floating, but I think if you practice, you'll be successful. And even if it's not perfect, it's not going to be perfect at first, you know? You got to be a beginner at some point. But This is such a cute little random act of kindness. Now I'm gonna do some that are ornaments and some, like these are ornaments, but I'm gonna do the ones I do today. I'm gonna make them into pins because I have a bunch of pins. I'm just gonna E6000 that on the back too. And they're super cute. So I hope you enjoyed that. And happy holidays. Thanks for watching. I just wanted to come back real quick. Just remember I said, okay, so I'm finishing up. You make sure you sign it. So sign the back of it after you've painted it gold. But see how some of the red got on the top? So I just basically take my finger and I go this way. And just, you can use a brush, but it's just as easy to just rub it along and you just get a nice clean looking edge. So hold it and just rub it along the edge. All right, I think that's it now. I just wanted to make sure I finished it up because I felt bad because I took so long telling you how to float. But because it's really a quick and easy project, but look how pretty that gold paint looks on the edge. And then put your little pom, after you varnish, put your little pom-pom. All right, but don't forget to sign it. Sign it and do your gold background and your edges. So see how you just, it looks great. All right, you guys, that's it. Thanks for watching.